important members of API and delegates sitting in front of me. At the outset, I would like to extend my sincere thanks and gratitude to Dr. Anuj Maheshwari, Dr. Jayant Panda, and Dr. Srinivas Murthy and the organizing team for giving me the opportunity to be a part of this very prestigious conference of American College of Physicians. The topic which has been allotted to me, when I fail to control blood pressure, that is approach to resistant hypertension. The flow presentation of my talk will be prevalence of hypertension, what is resistant hypertension, approach to resistant hypertension, and then management of resistant hypertension. We all know that hypertension is a global health crisis. More than 1 million of people are affected all over the world because of hypertension, and 1 out of 4 men and 1 out of 5 women are suffering from hypertension. And there is an unmet need is extensive because there is a decrease in level of awareness, level of diagnosis, treatment, and control remains very low. Less than 20% of people who are taking antihypertensive medication can control blood pressure at a target level. And hypertension is the number one risk factor for death. 12.8% of all deaths globally is because of hypertension. Hypertension is a big risk for CAD, stroke, heart failure, and kidney disease. And just reducing 10 millimeter of systolic blood pressure can reduce major events of cardiovascular by 20%, stroke by 27%, CAD by 17%, heart failure by 28%, and mortality by 13%. So hypertension, which is being taken very simply, is a really, if it is uncontrolled, a big problem. Overall prevalence in India, from National Family Health Survey 4, there is a significant increase in national and regional prevalence of hypertension according to the 2017 ACC-AHA guidelines, and there is an increase by 2.3 times, that is from 18.5% to 43% with the new guidelines of American Heart Association. So when I fail to control BP, that is difficult to treat hypertension. What is difficult to treat hypertension? It is refractory hypertension, has often been used interchangeably with resistant hypertension. According to the number of PubMed citations, resistant hypertension has been used much more commonly with refractory hypertension to say that the patient is have hypertension resistant to pharmacotherapy or difficult to treat hypertension. So commonly used word is difficult to treat hypertension for resistant hypertension. So what is resistant hypertension? Resistant hypertension can be defined as blood pressure that remains above goal. Above goal, in spite of concurrent use of 3 antihypertensive agents of different classes, you have to three antihypertensive agents of different classes and blood pressure remaining above goal, and one of the 3 agents should be diuretic, one of them should be a diuretic, and all agents should be prescribed in an optimal dose amount. This was the statement of AHA in 2008. And what is controlled resistant hypertension? When you can control blood pressure with more than 3 antihypertensive agents. But then there was some change in the AHA guidelines in 2018, and what they say that resistant hypertension, when they need 3 or more medications to treat blood pressure, but still have blood pressure that exceeds the goal for hypertension. Goal for hypertension, what is goal for hypertension? I'll let you know. According to the 2017 AHA-ACC guidelines for hypertension, and what they have changed then, from optimum, the antihypertensive drug should be administered at a maximum or maximally tolerated daily doses. So what is the goal? 2017 AHA, hypertension diagnosed when systolic blood pressure between 130 to 139 and diastolic blood pressure 80 to 89. And if you go with the threshold for diagnosing hypertension by home BP monitoring or ambulatory BP monitoring, the American guideline says 130-80 for clinic. European guideline says 140-90. And then International Society of Hypertension says 140-90. And the same with the Asian guidelines. So any blood pressure which is 130-80 is the targeted to keep the blood pressure to normal range. The hypertension classification, with the number of antihypertensive medications, controlled hypertension when patient is taking two tablets, two antihypertensive drugs, when he is taking three antihypertensives, then it is not controlled, then it is resistant hypertension. And when he is taking four tablets antihypertensive drug, it is controlled resistant hypertension. And if the blood pressure is not controlled with more than four or five medications, it is refractory hypertension. What is the prevalence? It is between 12 to 15% of patients treated with high blood pressure. Those who are taking treatment for hypertension, among them, it is 12 to 15%. Then who is at risk of resistant hypertension? Those who are having older age, female sex, excessive dietary salt ingestion, having evidence of left ventricle hypertrophy, and those who have got a high blood pressure at baseline, obesity, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, and plaque. And what are the comorbidities? Obesity, diabetes, and CKD, all these are present. If they are present, they add to unfavorable and adverse prognosis if blood pressure is not kept at a targeted level. And all population-based studies on hypertension, if there is a target organ damage, then the risk of MI, stroke, heart failure, and end-stage kidney disease are directly related to the level of high blood pressure. So now, this is a population of uncontrolled hypertension. Which of these patients have treatment-resistant hypertension? Not all patients with uncontrolled hypertension are treatment-resistant, because majority of the patients who are diagnosed as resistant hypertension are pseudo-resistance hypertension, and very less number of patients who are diagnosed as a resistant hypertension are really the resistant hypertension or true resistant hypertension. A very interesting study research article which included 69 patients of resistant hypertension. The 30% were non-adherent to the medicines, 20% were white coat resistant. So overall 50% with pseudo-resistant hypertension, those who were diagnosed as resistant hypertension. And most of were under-treated with none receiving chlorothalidone or spironolactone. Only 40% receiving maximum doses of ACE inhibitors or ARBs, and only 15% receiving maximum doses of calcium channel blockers. So most of the patients who are diagnosed as resistant hypertension are, big number is pseudo-resistance. What is pseudo-resistance? They include suboptimal BP measurement, white coat effect, poor adherence to drug therapy, clinical inertia, an important factor for pseudo-resistant, not titrating antihypertensive medication to control blood pressure target level. And lastly, not adopting lifestyle modification. So this is a common practice among physicians not to take blood pressure as been advised or as been dictated. This is the slide which tells the right position and right way of taking blood pressure. Feet flat on floor, arm bare and resting mid-arm at heart level. You should take three readings at a 1 minute interval. Discard the first reading and then take the average of second and third reading. That will be the real actual measurement of right way of taking blood pressure. White coat hypertension. What is white coat hypertension? The blood pressure which is more at doctor's clinic than at home, common in patients whom we think that they are suffering from resistant hypertension. 20% of such patients achieve when they are treated with the right medicines, less target organ damage in patients with pseudo-resistant hypertension. More target organ damage in pseudo-resistant hypertension. That's how you can detect who is at pseudo-resistance. Detected by home or ambulatory BP monitoring. So when we want to rule out white coat hypertension, the best thing is ambulatory BP measurement. But even at home BP monitoring, you can detect, you can rule out white coat hypertension by taking 6 readings in 6 measurements in the day, morning, evening, afternoon, and night. So non-compliance is the most common cause of pseudo-resistance. It is because of side effects of the drugs, complexity of the regime, treatment failure, issue of cost, patient level of literacy and education. 56% patients take less than 25% of targeted dose during discharge, and 76.4% patients had no titration even after 3 weeks. This is what is clinical inertia. So it has been rightly said, drugs don't work in patients who don't take them. Then poor adherence. Poor adherence is also a very important cause of pseudo-resistance. 40% of newly diagnosed hypertensive discontinue drug within 1 year, and 40% of the remaining patients continue therapy over next 10 years, thinking that they have controlled their blood pressure and they are cured of blood pressure. So education from the physician is very important, that they have to take lifelong treatment until they have normal blood pressure. And adherence can improve if using drugs with low side effects, such as ACE inhibitors and ARB, drugs with once daily doses in combination of multiple drugs, pill box, family support is always needed, and improved patient education by any way is very, very important. The clinical inertia, an important factor for pseudo-resistance, conscious decision by a physician or a clinician not adequately treat or titrate drug, a condition in spite of knowing that it is present. Not adopting lifestyle modification, they are the most, as already been told by the previous speakers, that lifestyle modification are very, very important, and it should be the first line on your prescription about lifestyle modification, because weight reduction, dash diet eating, sodium restriction, physical activity, alcohol abstinence, and all put together can reduce systolic blood pressure by 20 to 50 millimeters of mercury. So there is a great importance of lifestyle modification, weight reduction, and the diet control is most important. Then very important thing, that we must rule out secondary hypertension, because 5 to 10% of patients with resistant hypertension have an identifiable cause for hypertension. Most common are parenchymal disease, renal arterial disease, primary aldosteronism, and obstructive sleep apnea are common causes of secondary hypertension. The incidence increases with the increasing age. Renal disease, sleep apnea, and possibly primary aldosteronism are more prevalent among older patients. Drugs and blood pressure control. Many drugs are responsible for increased blood pressure. NSAIDs, COX inhibitors, oral contraceptives, corticosteroids. Then careful about black licorice and herbal products or Ayurvedic products that the patient is taking. And careful about ruling out illicit drugs like cocaine, alcohol, and caffeine. So drugs have got very important role in increasing blood pressure. So what is the etiology of resistant hypertension? The most important is elevated levels of aldosterone and excessive volume are the most common and most important cause of resistant hypertension, endothelial dysfunction, insulin resistance, genes, and sympathetic overactivation are other causes. So excess volume because of dietary sodium, reduction of reduced GFR, aldosterone excess, and then vascular resistance by RAS activation, SNS activation, and arterial remodeling are important causes, and they combine together to produce resistant hypertension. So the persistent intravascular fluid retention is a multifactorial: hyperaldosteronism, obesity, African American race, chronic kidney disease, high dietary intake, heightened sodium sensitivity, for which VEDS are very prone. These are the causes for excessive fluid retention. And a very important study for fluid retention, which justifies the fluid retention, is the cause for resistant hypertension pathway 2 study, which said that after titrating spironolactone to 50 milligram from 25 milligram at 12 weeks, had much more BP reduction as compared to titrating high doses of doxazosin, bisoprolol, and placebo. And the magnitude of BP reduction in patients with the lowest renin levels had an average of 20 millimeter reduction in home systolic blood. So spironolactone is one of the most important drugs for resistant hypertension, and you can go to increase the doses by 50 milligram from 25 milligram, and you can reduce blood pressure to great extent. Then prognosis is not known. No study specifically powered to address this issue, but those who are having a resistant hypertension, naturally, the risk of MI, stroke, heart failure, and renal failure are directly related to the level of blood pressure. Investigations, ABPM is the best to rule out early ECG, echo, CBC, blood sugar, renal function test, 24 hours, urine sodium, albumin, aldosterone, plasma aldosterone, renin ratio, and Doppler to exclude secondary hypertension. Just a minute. Treatment pharmacologic therapy, including administration of at least 3 antihypertensive substances, usually ARBs, ACE inhibitors, and a diuretic. And since the non-dipper pattern is the most common for resistant hypertension, one of the antihypertensive medications should be given at bedtime to control night blood pressure. The combination of drugs, you can use diuretics with ARBs, diuretics with calcium channel blockers, ARBs with calcium channel blockers, ARBs with diuretic or beta blockers, but you cannot use ARBs and ACE inhibitors. They are contraindicated. The device therapy, carotid baroreceptors, they cause a stimulation of these receptors, and there is a sympathetic discharge to the heart, peripheral vasculature, and the kidneys, and reduces blood pressure. And the new HOPE trial, piribistate, an oral brain penetrating prodrug, a selective and a specific inhibitor of APA, blocks formation of angiotensin 3 from angiotensin 2 and decreases blood pressure. This is also being tried and being used. But the most important, renal denervation was the most important, and the Simplicity 1 trial and second trial showed very encouraging results for decrease in the blood pressure in patients with resistant hypertension. But then Simplicity 3 trial failed, and then it was stopped, and it was found that it is not working. So then came the recent renal denervation shame control RCTs, the spiral hypertension on med, spiral hypertension off med, and radiance hypertension solo. And they showed that the blood pressure, systolic blood pressure, can be reduced to 9 millimeter of mercury, and diastolic blood pressure can be reduced to 6 millimeter of mercury. And then very recently in 2021, ACC, there was a paper that ultrasound renal denervation for hypertension resistant to a triple medication pill, that is a radiation, radiance hypertension trio, a randomized multicentric single blind shame control trial showed that there is a reduction of blood pressure by 9 millimeter of mercury systolic blood pressure, even in the office BP or home BP. So it was found that this will work as a renal denervation therapy and is a promising. Then the future of the antihypertensive treatment is the precision medicine. In future is the precision medicine has come, time of precision medicine has come. What is precision medicine? Classifying patients into subgroups that differ in susceptibility of disease, biology, prognosis of disease, and respond to treatment. So this traditional medicine is the same therapy which we are giving. It benefits to someone, then someone are not benefited, and then someone are, a group of patients are, have adverse side effects. But in precision medicine, after DNA testing, we tailored therapy, and every group of patients are benefited. So there is a future for precision medicine, and advances in genomics and informative technology will allow for more precise treatment of high blood pressure. Till then, current management of hypertension should continue to focus. And we know that genomics of hypertension,
sir, please,
there will be a road
summarize
to
it.
Precision medicine.
Sir, we are running short.
Okay,
time.
Okay, last day. Take home message. The most important effective management needs careful evaluation, exclusion of pseudo-resistance, identification and modifying factors related to BP rise. RNT therapy as a device-based intervention could potentially simulate a paradigm shift in the management of resistant hypertension. So I conclude my talk here, and thank you everybody for listening. And it is my proud privilege to invite all of you to APICON 2022 in Jaipur between 11th March and 14th March. You are all welcome. We are eager to welcome all of you.